Beauty and the Beast is one of Disney's most iconic princess movies. So iconic that it was one of the first movies given a live-action adaptation. Yay for cash grabs! I feel like many people's favorite song is Be Our Guest, but man, the mob song gets me every time and is by far my favorite part of the movie. As I was singing it in the shower the other day, I realized that Gaston and the mob were morally justified, which was kind of a crazy thought that I wanted to explore in a short video essay. So for all the new viewers, welcome to On the Other Hand. Gaston and the people in the village are introduced to the Beast much later in the movie than we are, specifically when Maurice barges into the tavern.
Help! Someone help me!
Maurice?
Please, please, I need your help. He's got her locked in the dungeon.
Who?
Belle, we must go. Not a minute to lose.
Whoa, slow down, Maurice. Who's got Belle locked in a dungeon?
A beast! A horrible, monstrous beast!
So it seems rather cruel to laugh at him and throw him out. But even though the villagers were mean, they weren't unreasonable. Keep in mind, we as the audience were directly introduced to magic, and that the beast is both human and redeemable right at the start of the movie. The villagers had no such luxury. This story takes place in the 1700s or 1800s, and even though the villagers were probably a superstitious bunch, it's not surprising that they wouldn't believe a rambling tavern tale of a beast. So they hear an unbelievably large and scary beast captured Belle, but because they don't have the same context as us, they understandably assume that
he's a little punch drunk. One too many hits with a snake.
The next time we see the villagers and Gaston is when they come to take Maurice to the asylum. To be clear, I'm trying to show that Gaston and the villagers' decision to form a mob was morally justified. Not that they were acting in good faith or that they were good people. So Maurice recounts his antics, but this time a magic mirror is pulled out that shows the beast, and Belle talks about how caring and kind the beast is. Now Gaston probably has to reconsider what Maurice said earlier, that there is a beast, and he did lock Belle in a dungeon. Belle didn't deny being imprisoned, so is it any surprise that Gaston suspects that the beast put a spell on Belle, rather than the more nuanced story that definitely wasn't Stockholm Syndrome that we saw? So Gaston and the villagers are faced with the reality of magic, and a beast who is intelligent and powerful, possibly also able to cast spells. That's quite intimidating. Is it any wonder that the villagers' first thought is to protect their family and community? I don't think so. I'd say the villagers turning into a mob is morally justified for what information they had. An interesting question to consider is how immediate was their danger, and should they have spent more time gathering facts? Presumably, the villagers could have questioned Maurice and Belle, and they could have discovered Chip and made a far more informed decision than they did. If the villagers had all the facts that we the audience had and still formed a mob to kill the beast, the mob definitely wouldn't be justified anymore. How we view morality has a lot to do with the facts that are known at the time the decision is made. And it is a tough moral call to balance finding answers with time-sensitive threats. I would also like to reflect on the morality of mobs in general. When this movie conflict is resolved and the spell is broken, the beast magically heals from his fatal wound, and it would seem like any damage caused to the castle or its residents is undone. The happy ending and erasing of consequences doesn't happen with real-life mobs. The violence shown in the movie is very cartoon and slapstick, but in real life, mobs are quite destructive. So here are some thoughts to consider. The snowflake doesn't blame itself for the avalanche, but what blame does each individual member of a mob deserve for the destruction performed by the group? If a mob is formed for enforcing justice or for protection, is it still justified if people are hurt or killed as a result? And what responsibility do leaders and followers have to learn more about a problem before grabbing a torch and pitchfork and acting out of fear or anger? These questions don't have easy answers, but that's why they are
food for thought.
As always, thanks, hope you enjoyed, and if you did, consider subscribing and hitting the bell so you'll get notified for new uploads.